Welcome to the Wyoming Planning Commission meeting for Tuesday, March 21, 2023. Ashley, would you please call the roll?
Commissioner Gilreath Watts.
Here.
Hall.
Here.
Lamer.
Here.
Randall.
Here.
Smart.
Here.
Zapata.
Here.
Maselli.
Here. I need a motion to approve the absence of Commissioner Van Duren and Commissioner Weller. Thank you. Second?
Support.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passed. Before we move further, first of all, I'd like to welcome two new planning commissioners, Roger Lamer and Alex Smart, to the Planning Commission for the City of Wyoming. Welcome, and we look forward to years of service and your knowledge and helping move Wyoming in the right direction and a brighter future.
Thank you.
Yep. You're welcome. Minutes. Commissioners, any questions, changes, or concerns regarding the minutes of the last meeting? If none, meeting stands. Approval of the agenda. Jordan, is there any changes? No changes to the agenda. The agenda will stand. At this time, I'm going to open up public comment on non-public hearing agenda items. This public comment period is reserved for the comment on non-public hearing items only. It's important to note that this is not an opportunity for dialogue or debate, but an opportunity to provide comment to the Planning Commission. Upon approaching the bench, please begin by giving your name and your address, and there is a 3-minute time limit. Seeing none, I will close the public comment on non-public hearing items. Ashley, could you please read agenda item number one?
Agenda item number one is a request to amend zoning code sections 90-320, automobile service stations and public garages, and 90-508, requirements for permitted uses after special use approval, Wyoming planning staff.
Jordan.
Good evening, commissioners. So staff is proposing two text amendment changes to the zoning code, both related to automobile service stations. Those are also known as gas stations. I might refer to them as either throughout the presentation, so just know that. So I will cover that in the next few slides here. So through continued review of the zoning code, staff has identified that there are a couple language related to automobile service stations that's outdated and could further be clarified to better capture existing practices. The code is silent and inadvertently restrictive in a couple different sections, and I will cover that over the next couple slides here. One is related to outdoor equipment at gas stations. So right now, the city's zoning code only states that gas pumps are the only type of outdoor equipment that can be used at a gas station. However, the code fails to mention self-service air compressors and vacuums. Those are both things that we constantly see at just about every gas station in the city of Wyoming and across America. So both are seen throughout Wyoming and are also not out of character for the zoning district. They don't create a lot of noise, not a lot of, you know, vision blight as well. So it's something that we see commonly. But right now our code is silent on that. So if someone were to ask us, could we install an air compressor at our gas station, we don't really have clarity of whether or not that's permitted or not. So this would provide clarification through this text amendment. So in green text, you'll see that is the proposed language under number 3. The second area pertains to drive opening distances from interior lot lines. So the code currently requires all drive openings into gas stations to be more than 20 feet from any interior lot line. So if you look at that image that I have on the screen, you'll see the drive opening in the southeast corner of that site. That site is the gas station Wendy's combination that's on the corner of Burlingame 28th Street, just down the way here. And then the line to the south is the interior lot line. So right now, if you wanted to start a gas station in the city of Wyoming, it's saying that the drive opening has to be 20 feet away from that southern property line. There are very few gas stations in the city that meet that requirement. And if you look at vacant sites that could be best used for gas stations, they would not be eligible because of this language. So what staff is now proposing is to make it so that these drive openings be 20 feet away from interior lot lines only when adjacent to a residential district. That allows gas stations to locate in areas that are most feasible, but also protects residential districts when those two types of districts touch. It's seldom, but it gives that extra protection just in case. So there is where it would be added into the code. This is a table somewhere in the middle that pertains to special use requirements. So you'll see the word residential added there in green. So with that, the development review team recommends that Planning Commission adopt the recommended text amendment to zoning code sections 90-320 and 90-508, and recommends the same to City Council. And staff is available for questions if there are any.
Thank you, Jordan. At this time, I'd like to open up public comment. Again, this is a public comment period and it's reserved for public hearing items only. Again, it's important to note that it's not an opportunity for dialogue or debate, but an opportunity to provide comment to the Planning Commission. Upon approaching the podium, please begin providing your name, your address, and there's a 3-minute time limit. Seeing none, I will close the public hearing. Would the developer like to come up? Seeing not, commissioners. In front of us, we have a request to amend the zoning code section 90-320 automobile service stations, public garages, and 90-508 requirements for permitted use after special use approval. I need a motion to amend the zoning code.
So moved.
So moved by Commissioner Hall.
Support.
Support by Commissioner Zapata. Questions, comments, or concerns, commissioners? Seeing none, Ashley, would you please call the vote?
Commissioner Gilreath Watts?
Yes.
Hall?
Yes.
Lamer?
Yes.
Randall?
Yes.
Smart?
Yes.
Zapata?
Yes.
Maselli?
Yes. Motion passes. Ashley, would you please read agenda item number 2?
Agenda item number 2 is a request to approve condominium documents for 765 and 747 44th Street Southwest, Section 24, V&W Horiuchi LLC.
Good evening, commissioners.
Good evening.
So this is a request to approve some condo documents. And you can see a picture of the site here. It's the Arby's in a small office building on the corner of 44th Street and Clyde Park. One thing to clarify, a condo is a system of separate ownership of individual units within a shared site. This is not exclusive to housing. So you can condo office buildings, you can condo multiple buildings on one site. This existing site contains an Arby's restaurant and the small office building. The applicant would like to keep both buildings on the same parcel, and in fact, it's not possible to split this parcel, but separate ownership and responsibility for the two buildings through a condominium agreement. Both buildings would continue to share some common elements, including stormwater and parking. So the site would continue to operate as it's currently arranged. If the agreement is approved, Arby's will continue as a restaurant. The office building will be filled with a future tenant. No new construction is proposed, and the city zoning code does require the Planning Commission approve all condominium agreements. So the development review team recommends that Planning Commission adopt the condominium documents for 765 and 747 44th Street Southwest, subject to conditions 1-3. Staff is available for comments or questions.
Thank you, Paul. At this time, I'd like to open up public comment on agenda item number 2. Oh, seeing none. Close. Developer? Would the developer like to come up? Again, please state your name, your address, and you have 10 minutes.
My name is Leif Barish. I'm here on behalf of V&W Horiuchi LLC. Address is 747 44th Street Southwest. And I just wanted to clarify that the conditions of 1-3, I believe, have been satisfied, and maybe you guys can confirm that.
We know that condition 1 has been satisfied. We're still working with our engineering department to confirm 2 and 3, but we don't think that this is necessary to hold up any approvals from a staff perspective.
I did receive an email from Jeff Onk, is it? Who just sent it, I believe, yesterday, saying that all the conditions are resolved, but I'll let you guys clarify that with them. Thank you. That's all I have.
Thank you. All right. Commissioners, in front of us, we have the development review team recommends that the Planning Commission grant site condominium approval to the BW Horucci LLC at 765 and 744 44th Street Southwest. Subjects, conditions 1 through 3. I need a motion. Commissioners. Motion by Zapata. Seconded by Randall, Commissioner Randall. Questions, comments, concerns, commissioners? Seeing none, Ashley, would you please call the vote?
Commissioner Gilarith Watts?
Yes.
Paul?
Yes.
Lamer?
Yes.
Randall?
Yes.
Smart?
Yes.
Zapata?
Yes.
Maselli?
Yes. Motion passes. Ashley, if you could please read agenda item number 3.
Agenda item number 3 is a request for site plan approval for 868, 886, 898, 910, and 920 Barnum Street Southwest, Section 26, Roman Manufacturing and Copper Rock Construction.
Jordan.
Thank you. Yes, so this is a proposal for a new building addition. A existing building is being proposed to be torn down and then a new one be put up. I will explain that over the next few slides here. So this site contains 5 different parcels that front Barnum Street, Clyde Park Avenue is to the east, and just south of here is 47th Street. So on your map there in front of you, you'll see that the 5 parcels that we're looking at are all shaped in green there. You'll see that there's an existing building in the southeast corner, and there's another existing building in the southwest corner. Through this presentation, I'll point out that the building in the southeast corner is being proposed to be removed and then a new building be put up in its place. The zoning map, this section of the city is zoned I-1 light industrial. The proposed use is a manufacturing property, so it would fall in line with the zoning there. So here's the proposed site plan that was included in all of your packets. The site consists of 5 parcels that are proposed to be combined. Roman Manufacturing is the applicant, and they are seeking a new building space for transformer manufacturing. Again, they'd be demolishing the existing building in the southeast corner of the site and would be building a new 27,160 square foot building for manufacturing office space. And you'll see that on your screen to the right there. I might even put a box. Yep, I did. So right there in green, that is where the new building would be placed. The site can be accessed off of Barnum Street to the north. There's a couple different drives up there, including a fire lane. And then there's also a drive access to the south of the screen that connects onto another parcel that's owned by Roman. New landscaping is also going to be proposed throughout the site. Here's a couple of examples of elevations. So the north elevation is the one that would face Barnum Street. So if you're driving down Barnum, that is the side that you would see. And with that, I'll go through staff's findings of fact for the project. For adequacy of information, the site plan contains an appropriate amount of detail to sufficiently understand the project. The plan meets minimum dimensional requirements. The plan meets minimum requirements related to privacy. Again, this is a very industrial district, so a lot of the buildings meet those standards already. Preservation of natural areas. Existing natural features will be maintained and are not affected by the proposed development. Again, additional landscaping has been proposed throughout the site. Adequate stormwater management can be provided on site. The applicant is continuing to work with the city's engineering department to ensure that all stormwater management requirements are met. Appropriate measures are provided related to soil erosion. Adequate ingress and egress are provided to the site. Adequate circulation and emergency vehicle access are provided. Adequate vehicular circulation is provided. The site provides limited pedestrian circulation. Again, this is an industrial site. No adverse impact on existing roads or traffic patterns are anticipated with this project, and the city's engineering department confirmed that. The site can be served by public utilities and services. all site development standards will be met. For alignment with the master plan, the land use map identifies for this site to be planned for business park, which relates to business park and light industrial uses. So the proposed manufacturing facility aligns with that light industrial vision. So with that, staff recommends that the Planning Commission grant site plan approval for the proposed project at 868, 886, 898, 910, and 920 Barnum Street Southwest, subject to conditions 1 through 14. And staff is available if there are questions.
Thank you, Jordan. At this time, I'd like to open up the public hearing. No public hearing. No public hearing. So, commissioners, as you heard in front of us, the developer review team recommends that the Planning Commission grant site plan approval for the proposed projects at 868, 886, 898, 910, and 920 Barnum Street Southwest, subjects to conditions 1 through 4. Need a motion, please. Motion by Commissioner Randall.
Support.
Support by Lehmer. Lehmer? Questions, comments, concerns?
Did you say conditions 1 through 4 instead of 1 through 14?
Excuse me, I apologize. 1 through 14. Thank you for the correction. Welcome to the club. We all try to support the chair here, you know. So, we like to make it fun, you know.
Yeah.
Come on. You can stay. So, anyways, so 1 through 14. Commissioners, comments, concerns?
I have a question. Whatever is being, I know once the building has been demolished and a new one goes in, will there be any concern for a noise level issue? Is that something that we need to be concerned with right now? I know it's in a business area, but is it going to add to the noise level in the area or not?
It's unlikely. All the manufacturing would take place within the building. So that's how that is mitigated. If there are issues, we do have a noise ordinance, so we do have inspectors that can go out and take a look and talk to the owners if there is some sort of noise issue. Sometimes that can be alleviated just from like overhead doors being open during the day and you can hear some sounds. So sometimes just closing those doors can alleviate some of those issues.
Thank you.
As a developer here, I have a question.
Yeah.
Can state your name and your address?
Good evening, my name is Don DeGroot. I'm with XL Engineering, 5252 Clyde Park. With me is Matthew from Copper Rock and Austin from Roman. So be happy to answer whatever questions you might have.
Just a quick question, once the building's done and complete, what's the occupancy, the employment headcount you anticipate?
I'd say less than 20.
New hires? Thank you. That's it.
Thank you.
Commissioners, anything else? Ashley, please call the vote.
Commissioner Gilereth-Watts?
Yes.
Hall?
Yes.
Lehmer?
Yes.
Randall?
Yes.
Smart?
Yes.
Zapata?
Yes.
Maselli?
Yes. Motion passes. You're welcome. All right. Take care of some paperwork here. Ashley, if you could please read agenda item number 4.
Agenda item number four is learning and growth.
Learning and growth. Tonight, we're going to get an update on the City Center by Tim Bradshaw. And Tim, thank you for coming.
Yeah. Thank you for the opportunity. I'm a planning commissioner myself in Caledonia Township where I live, so I get to sit on the other side.
Oh, there you go.
Just last night.
Welcome.
So thank you all for your service. I understand what you do with that same perspective. So again, I'm Tim Bradshaw. I'm the municipal practice leader at Progressive AE, and I'm the project manager overseeing this project for the city of Wyoming. Oops. Figure out how to do the slides here, maybe. As part of our team, Nolan Miller is a landscape architect. He's really talented in helping to develop urban spaces and make them inclusive and inviting. And Jess Howard is a trail specialist on our team, too, that have done a lot of the work that you'll see later on in the presentation. So some of the things we want to cover tonight is just what are the goals of the City Center project, and then an overview of the pedestrian bridge, some of the design elements that are included in it, how we're activating the space and making it an open urban environment. And then one of our constant themes is schedule and cost. When are we going to do it and how much does it cost? Then we'll transition to the private utility relocation, which supports the pedestrian bridge work and also the redevelopment of the 28th Street corridor, talking about some of those limits and goals, collaboration between different private utility companies, and again, schedule and cost. And then lastly, we'll wrap up with trail expansion and connectivity, some of the innovative tools that we're using to build the trails. There's some really challenging slopes that I enjoy as an engineer. I always love a difficult problem to solve. So we've got some exciting opportunities there. And again, tentative schedule and cost as we move forward. So especially for the new commissioners, I don't know how much background you've had on the City Center project. We're trying to create a new urban core in downtown Wyoming. And we're gonna do that with economic revitalization via increased residential density, which creates a sense of place with rapid and safe community connectivity and enriches people's experiences. We wanna do that by developing an integrated pedestrian network so that these folks, when they live here, can walk and get to the places that they need to go easily. And so we've got a conflict. 28th Street has 30,000 cars per day. That's critically important to our economic environment, but we also want to increase pedestrian demand, which causes a safety conflict. We need to provide an opportunity to solve that via the pedestrian bridge. And then one of the last goals of the City Center project is to provide new affordable housing, which I'm not going to talk much about tonight. That's really outside of Progressive AE scope, but there is additional significant housing units planned in the area. So this is an initial rendering of the pedestrian bridge that we're planning to construct across 28th Street at 28th West Place and Hook Avenue. This view is looking to the southwest from the Applebee's site. So there's a lot of things going on here, and actually I had some notes I wanted to touch on. So this entire bridge is ADA compliant, which means that the slopes to get up it do not exceed 5%. And we need to be, I think this is a touch screen too, maybe, yep. So we need to be 16 feet over the road at the center line here. So that's one of our design constraints so that semis and other equipment can get through, you know, continue to get through 28th Street safely. And it takes about 350 feet at about a 5% slope to get up that high. So that's a really long distance from both ends of the bridge to get up and over. But we also want to make sure that, number one, you can do that easily and safely in a wheelchair, and also that you're not going too fast on a bike. A 5% slope isn't insignificant. So we want this to be comfortable for children and families, too, as they're descending down the bridge. So those slopes are important. We also know that there's other folks that are just walking east-west down 28th Street on the existing sidewalks. So they may not want to walk the 300 feet to the main entrance on the trail on either side. So that's why there's stairs proposed on each side of the bridge too. We would hate to put in a $6 million investment and then still have people to cross at grade. We want to encourage any safe crossings that we can. From a branding perspective, you can kind of see, I don't think I want to draw on it because I'll cover it up, but there's a white line that kind of goes all the way across the bridge, and that's really a flattened W. We think of that W as being wide open and open arms, welcome to Wyoming, is kind of some of the branding that our design team has put on that. And so that's got its own independent lighting. The imagery shown here is kind of at dusk, so you're able to start to see some of the lighting. I'll have some additional slides that are more in the nighttime, which you can see other options. And again, you'll be able to see this from a long distance away as you approach on 28th Street. So we want this to be iconic and really be a sense of arrival. You've reached downtown.
Can I ask a question about the structure itself?
Sure.
What is the surface of the bridge? For like the...
The walking surface?
Yeah, the walking surface.
Concrete.
Concrete, okay, yep. Thank you.
And that's another important thing I meant to note. So snow melt is proposed to be a part of the bridge. Shoveling and maintaining, you know, something of this complexity is a challenge. So we're gonna do that by melting the snow off so that it just drains. And that's great for safety, that's great for longevity of the bridge, not having salt on the bridge, which has a lot of steel components, and also mainly made of concrete. Salt isn't really friendly to either of those items, so that really helps improve the longevity. Yes,
I got a quick question on that rendering you're showing us here, and I get it that it's just a rendering. The composite, the material of the bridge, I take it it's going to have the little holes as we're looking at now?
Yes.
Is that going to be a coated steel? It looks like it's going to be like a white or a grayish coated?
Yep. It's a 3/8-inch thick steel panel. And so there's a few different things going on, and maybe I'll draw again. So this top cord here of the structural steel, that's at 10 feet tall. MDOT requires a guard of 10 feet tall so that anybody going over the pedestrian bridge, not to say that they couldn't throw something over, but it's harder at that level. Our design team and the input that we've received from staff and public input too, is to actually exceed that. So you can see that the panels go up above that 10 foot structural member support to about 14.5 feet tall. We wanted to have a consistent arc as part of that design. And yes, so then the other constraint from MDOT is you can't have a hole bigger than 2 inches because they don't want you to be able to throw big things through the fence either. So the holes that you see above the white W are 2 inches, the maximum. And then there's some smaller ones below that are just 1 inch. So there's some variability, but also transparency so that you can see people on the bridge, and the people on the bridge can also feel comfortable that they're being seen. So I'll keep going. Is there an easy way to clear my scribbles? Sorry. Thank you. So this is another view from the southeast looking toward the northwest along 28th West Place. And just wanted to show, again, how long the bridge is and what it takes to get up from existing grade, and also connectivity to the proposed development that the city's partnering with a developer on, as we look at some potential increased high-density housing. We've got an opportunity in the lower left for maybe a food truck gathering space and another public gathering opportunity. There's some bulky design elements along the proposed entrance. These large balls here help to ensure that pedestrians have the safety that they need from cars. And the intent with this sidewalk coming through the entrance and exit of the housing complex is that would stay up above grade. So it gives the pedestrians priority. It keeps them higher and is a good ADA compliance and best practice. And it just kind of sets the tone that if I'm a car entering or exiting the site, I need to slow down because there's a 6-inch grade change here. There's a lot of lighting already existing along 28th West Place, and a lot more lighting proposed as part of the design. So that'll be well lit for safety. And it's kind of a small element here, but this is a bridge abutment, this lighter blue line just above the blue line that I drew. And we see that as a mural opportunity for the community, something to paint, you know, a nice family-oriented mural to celebrate this public space.
That's the same on both sides?
Yeah, and I guess I don't. Yeah, there's another image coming that'll show the other side too. So this is just a different, similar view looking north from the south side of 28th Street up toward the water tower. along, you know, what the future building face might look like for this mixed-use commercial and high-density residential building. This was a different design than the one we ended up with, but one of the concepts that we had looked at. And again, on the far side of 28th Street, you can see the stairs and also a multicolored abutment with a potential mural opportunity. And active site furniture, again, encouraging gathering and activity in the space. Pedestrian scale lighting kind of shown by each of these posts to make it active and bright. And here is some imagery of what the bridge could look like at night. We have lighting proposed on both the inside and the outside of the bridge. We want to make sure that as cars are coming up to this, that again, they know this is the city center. You've reached downtown Wyoming, and make sure this is an iconic piece. And then also from the inside, make sure that it's safe and comfortable for pedestrians as they're crossing it. This is a zoomed out view looking southerly from the north side of the Applebee's site, kind of giving you again that grand scale of an overall 700 foot long pedestrian bridge. You can see the lighting on the inside of the bridge is generally within the handrail. There's little LED diodes every 5 feet or so underneath the bottom of the rail that light up the entire pathway. And again, along 28th, right at the 28th Street crossing, there's lights on the outside that shine upward. We wanted to shine upward and not down at the cars to make sure that we're not causing any blinding lights or any potential traffic issues.
Where's the Applebee?
Sorry about that.
That's that.
I'm very familiar with it because I work with it all the time. But okay. Yep, this is Applebee's.
That's what I
And just about done going through bridge items here, but also wanted to talk about the lighting. So it's with what we can do with LED lighting today and the different drivers. There's 3,200 different colors that the city could choose from. They can operate that remotely. We continue to have conversations with MDOT about what colors can be used. For instance, when I did this presentation to City Council, they asked, could we make it red and green at Christmas time? And I said, functionally, you absolutely can. But whether that's allowed with MDOT, I'm not sure, because red and green, of course, are traffic signal colors and we don't want to confuse drivers. So we're working through what colors we can and can't use, and that'll be part of a future agreement between MDOT and the city.
Would the city be able to control the lights?
Yeah.
You know, so if they wanted to put Merry Christmas instead of lights, you know, spell out Merry Christmas with the digital lights, they could do that?
I don't think so. So MDOT is very sensitive about really any branding or wording or messaging within the public right away. So I think we could do colors. Which colors? I'm still not sure. So Christmas in particular is a tough one because of the red.
How about banners? And the reason why I say that is the major overpass pedestrian heated air conditioned walkway by Calvin College, they hold banners up there periodically. Is that approved by DOT or against law, or are they just taking a chance? Because people are going to ask once this goes up.
Yeah.
It's a great advertising sign.
Absolutely. I think MDOT is going to not permit banners or advertising, whether they enforce, you know, similar to Calvin, if a student were to put a, you know, Go Knights sign up there, it might sit for a few days until, you know, somebody realizes it or asks for it to be taken down. But yeah, I don't foresee, you know, AT&T or, you know, being able to sell.
No, I get that. Yeah.
But we'll continue, the city attorney will work through a lot of those issues with MDOT as that agreement is worked out.
Staff, that won't come back to us for approval, will it? I mean, okay.
No, this won't be coming back to you.
All right.
So I want to clarify that banners will not be allowed on the bridge. MDOT's been quite clear with us about that.
Thank you, Paul.
You're welcome. Paul, can the kids stuff the colored cups in the fence like they do the chain link fence and spell out Wyoming or whatever?
We would probably have multiple issues with the practice, but they would have to use Dixie cups because it's a 2-inch hole is the largest you're going to find on the bridge.
I think it's a great idea so far. So yeah.
Thank you. So kind of wrapping up the bridge portion of the presentation, this is the schedule and current costs. We kicked this project off back in June of 2022, wrapped up a lot of the conceptual portion of the design phase. In February, we're working on finishing the full design now through May and hoping to bid in June. Some of the actual construction work could happen this fall, where we would start to do removals and prepare the site for the abutments and the supporting bridge piers. And then the actual delivery of the bridge, we wouldn't expect until the spring of 2024, and then we would finish a lot of the landscaping and finish areas of the plaza and also incorporate the lighting, snowmelt system into the bridge deck, et cetera. So that's probably at least a 3-month operation. There's a lot to happen in the following spring. Any additional questions on bridge before I transition to private utilities?
I could say this is a really great place for teenagers to hang out. Would there be any type of security cameras or emergency phone that would be kind of, you know, stationed for that?
Sure. So I'll start, and Paul, please interrupt me if I head down a wrong rabbit hole. So there's power across all the bridge, so we would be able to provide security cameras. It's not currently included in our design, but we're kind of at the 50-60% stage where that would be something easy to add. And then the design of the bridge is intentionally wide open. Often a bridge like this has the abutments really close to the street because that's actually a cheaper way to build a bridge, but we wanted transparency for all the buildings around and the gathering space so that people could see and be out in the open. So we're optimistic that because it's so wide open, we won't have any issues with, you know, the wrong folks gathering.
Yeah, we'd rather keep the bridge a welcome, open place, and so there's no plans currently to install security cameras. As Tim mentioned, it's going to be wide open. There's going to be lighting inside and out, and there should be good visibility from both ends of the bridge as well as the traffic underneath. So,
and no emergency phones in case there's an emergency on the bridge?
No, with most people having cell phones these days, we've gotten away from the emergency phones for the most part. But there will be commercial businesses at the south end of the bridge, as well as that plaza. We're hoping that people enjoy that space well into the evening. So there should be plenty of people around. In fact, we're hoping that it's a gathering space at either end.
Yes, my question is for Paul and Jordan. As we develop the budget for this project, do we have an ongoing maintenance budget for the future of this bridge? I mean, I'm presuming the steel will be painted.
Yep.
So at some point, we're going to have to spend money repainting the bridge to keep it looking the way we want it to. The LED lights, I don't know if you're specifying fixtures or fixtures that will receive a lamp, but the LED fixtures, sometimes they're very expensive to replace because you can't just change the bulb. You have to change the whole fixture. So just wondering if the city is putting a budget, annual budget, for maintenance of this bridge, so that way it continues to be something to be proud of and it doesn't become a burden for us later to have to come up with money to maintain it.
Yes, that's a very important question. We, as a part of some of our grant applications, we had to do a benefit cost analysis that included both maintenance and replacement of the bridge and all of its various elements. So the bridge itself is expected to last approximately 50 years, but there would be ongoing maintenance along the way. The city is budgeting for the annual maintenance and upkeep of the bridge, as well as the full replacement in our capital improvement plan.
Excellent, thank you.
And kind of wrapping up costs, our current budgetary estimate for the bridge is $6.5 million. The city did receive an ARPA grant from Kent County for $6 million back in December, so the vast majority of that is paid for by that grant. And it is budgetary. Maybe we'll get lucky and it'll come in under $6 million. So. Any other questions on the bridge? All right, I'll move forward So to support the bridge, we have a conflict. There's existing utility wires in the way up at that elevation, so we need to move those. We're partnering with consumers, and there's six telecom providers, which you can kind of see in the before picture on the left side in the blue, and also MDOT. So part of these utilities is within MDOT right-of-way, and if we're going to move those underground, we need to permit that process with them and where they go. And some of it is already either outside MDOT's right-of-way, or there's not enough room to put them in underground within that right-of-way. So we've created easements, and the city's negotiating those easements with the property owners where we can't fit within MDOT's right-of-way. We're suggesting a carrier pipe with multiple conduits. Right now, there's just those six telecom providers that we need to relocate today, but we want to be forward-thinking and make sure, number one, we expect vastly increased demand because we're going to have many more residents living in this area than there are today. So in order to support that, we're probably going to need more telecom wires to support that. Plus, as technology continues to change and grow, you know, what's six today, maybe 30 in five years or 10 years. It's hard to predict how these technologies keep changing. So if we're going to do this, we want to do it well once, one time, and make sure that we're forward thinking and there's places for future technologies to go without tearing up the full corridor.
You might have said this, excuse me, you might have said this, but I didn't hear you. So when these go underground, this is all going to be fiber?
Not necessarily.
It's going to be a combination of fiber, copper?
The utility providers will just relocate physically what they have in the air today. Okay. And put it in the conduits in the ground. They may take that as an opportunity to upgrade services, you know, while they're doing the work, but our intent is just to provide a safe place underground to continue to provide the same service.
When does this start?
We can be ready to bid this portion of the work in approximately 2 weeks. We're holding off until we have all the property rights in hand. We don't want to put a project out that we don't have the property mm-hmm. rights to build. So the current bottleneck really is property acquisition. So we could be ready for construction as soon as May, I would say, on the early side. And consumers is on a similar but separate track. They need to design and ensure that their facilities are moved with their own teams, so they're not really a part of the telecommunications bundle. They have their own 12-foot easement outside of the easement that the city's providing. And their schedule is to start construction in June and go through September currently.
Boy, it would be nice if we could add fiber into that pipeline.
So you may recall that earlier this year you approved the MetroNet Fiber Hut for
we did.
Just down the road here.
Yes.
MetroNet is actually one of the reasons that we are putting in the larger duct bank, because we are expecting that they will use several of those slots, and they will be in addition to the six telecom providers that we already know about, and that there may be more competition in that market.
And I would agree with you. Thank you for that answer. I would agree with you, because I also think fiber, you upgrade the technology that's in the ground, and people will come if it's there.
I have a question for staff. What do you anticipate in terms of traffic disruption along 28th Street during the easement or during the process of going underground?
So Tim may be able to correct me here, but the traffic disruption should be relatively minimal during this phase. The bridge will involve disruption on at least one night, potentially two or three. They'll be assembling it on a site nearby from multiple pieces and then dropping it into place overnight. And then there may be some additional closures for pouring the concrete, if I recall correctly.
Yeah, so I'll start with the bridge. To set the bridge, we'll have to have a full closure of 28th Street for one night, and we'll coordinate. That'll likely be on a weekend. That'll be specified by MDOT as part of the permit when they eventually approve the work. As far as the private utility relocation, I would anticipate regular right lane closures to support the work. There's often those deceleration tapers, which they may be able to just close that portion and work in those areas to try to keep disruption to traffic to a minimum. And additionally, these contractors often prefer to work from the backside parking lot, which technically is a, you know, private property, but as long as they've gotten approval from those owners, that would also be a nice option to make sure that we're not impacting 20th Street traffic quite as bad.
So it'll be similar to standard utility maintenance along any road, basically?
Yeah, there will be the same, you know, typical road work ahead and construction barrels and the aero merge sign. Yep, all those things.
Thank you.
So when it comes to this relocation of utilities, is it only limited to the area affected by the bridge, or is it extended beyond
that? Yeah, it's almost like you knew what the next slide was going to be. Good question. So the current project limits are from Burlingame to roughly where we are at City Hall, at Michael and DeHoot, so just immediately east of that. The city long-term does have vision of extending this further to the east, but this is kind of the initial phase. And so the different colors that are shown on the map are red, that means it's existing MDOT or city-owned right-of-way where we have the property rights already in hand. Blue is areas that the city attorney is working with property owners to acquire those easements on the city's behalf. And then anything in green is property that Consumers Energy needs to go underground from their current aerial configuration. And then lastly, in orange, near Hook Avenue on the upper right, that is property that was needed from Applebee's to accommodate the pedestrian bridge. So we already kind of went over schedule. We, again, could be ready to bid really within a week or two if necessary. Construction could be as soon as April, I would say late April at this point in time, and would take probably 3 months. Once that is in the ground, we want to work with the existing telecom providers so that they can start transferring that into the conduits, because then as consumers is also constructing their work and transferring power down from the poles into their new underground, they're just gonna lay new electrical lines. So it wouldn't necessarily be a transfer, but we wanna make sure that those poles are clear so that when consumers is there, they can just pull them and we're done. We got a nice clean right away at that point. So the current budgetary estimate for this work is about $830,000. Note that this is only for the telecom portion. That does not include the consumer's costs. The city does have a separate agreement with consumers for that work.
Did Progressive AE develop these budgetary estimates, or do you work with someone else?
We did develop them, but we've also, we've got some peers, sub-consultants on our team that work in this space and have kind of double-checked our work, so to speak. So it's a group effort. Any other questions on private utility relocation? Okay. So this kind of goes back to the why again of why are we building a pedestrian bridge? Why are we doing all this investment? It's about trail connectivity. This is a map showing some of the trail work that, again, Progressive has been contracted by the city to achieve. Prairie Parkway across the bottom in the orange color has about 6,000 cars per day and has more lanes than are necessary. So a road diet makes a lot of sense here to provide a new bicycling facility on street that has a nice safe separation of 4 feet away from the cars. Which I'll show you on the next slide. That connects to Kent Trails, which is something that we want to bring the rest of the community, you know, downtown to the new city center. The black line crossing 28th Street, again, is roughly where the pedestrian bridge is proposed. The green line near the water tower in Hook Avenue in this area. Again, provides that connectivity to Pinery Park and also to Grace Christian University. The water tower is placed in a great spot. As a civil engineer, you always put those at high points. So from the water tower elevation down to Pinery Park is a 40-foot grade drop. And that's what I was talking about, using technologies. If we're gonna continue to make this an ADA compliant, gentle slope, that's really hard to go down 40 feet. So I'll show you some of our design ideas in coming slides. And lastly, just wanted to note the red trail also kind of connects you to Porter Street, which Porter Street has sidewalks all the way to Lamar Park. So really good connectivity. And I also kind of glossed over the high school. So there's a lot of good connection points shown here with each of these trails. So I mentioned the Prairie Parkway cross-section. This is what it would look like after we've repainted the existing boulevard. You've got a 5-foot sidewalk on the outside and about 7.5 feet for driveways, a 7-foot bike lane, a 4-foot striped protective buffer, and then you still have an 11-foot travel lane, and then the same thing on the other side of the boulevard. This just shows, it's kind of tough with all the foliage, but these are some of the steep slopes in the retention pond area that we're crossing, which was one of the green trails. So in order to do that, this is a helical pier system, which is recommended for the type of slopes that we're dealing with. You just kind of put an engineered screw into the ground that has the right amount of tension and resistance to hold up, you know, whatever trail components and loads that you might need on it. We are fortunate that the soils really throughout the project area are really good sand and pretty consistent. So that's been one of the blessings of the project. And then as you can see on the right side, they're kind of getting closer to the end of construction. You would also need a railing, which they didn't get to that portion yet here in the pictures, but there'll be a railing all along the drop-off side of where the trail is on the high slide of the slope, high side of the slope. This is the retention pond where we're proposing to build a wooden pedestrian bridge across it. It's kind of overgrown. A lot of trees have died, and there's some kind of existing timber fallen in the area. We are going to need to clear a few trees to bring the trail and pedestrian bridge through. But as part of our work, we're also going to try to reestablish a lot of native vegetation, make this a nice place that some of the schools may want to come by and have an opportunity to look at, you know, what is natural vegetation. This is a wetland. Try and give them some understanding of the natural environment. And the next slide. These are some of the similar type boardwalks that we would need to construct across that retention pond. It actually fills up to about a 12-foot tall elevation. We wanted to make sure that the walking surface for the boardwalk slash bridge is over that if the pond is completely full, so that it could always be used even right after a heavy rain event. We're partnering with Western Wood Structures, a firm that builds these nationwide. They're actually based out of Oregon. Built the pedestrian bridge across the Grand River in Lowell, I think 4 or 5 years ago now. And then kind of wrapping up the trail portion of the work, a lot of our preliminary design is kind of ongoing now in March and April. We're transitioning to full design and permitting in April and May, with hopes of having our design complete and ready to bid in June. The city is continuing to pursue grant opportunities to pay for a lot of this investment. So our construction right now is kind of to be determined on when the funding sources become a little bit more clear. And our current budgetary estimate for the trail work is 5.5 million. Thank you for listening to me in my monotone, boring engineering voice. I really enjoy the work, but I don't think that I sometimes get excited enough about sharing it in the way that I do.
No, Tim, you did a great job, but I tell you, that's exciting, that trail program.
Yeah.
Really expanding that's covering a lot of territory in Grand Rapids to make it really bikeable, walkable. That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Very cool.
I think the whole project.
I mean, just
coming back to Wyoming after.
It's a direction. Yeah, it's the right direction. Yeah.
Yeah, it's really nice. I'm happy to see that's happening.
Yeah.
Good job.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you.
Yeah, it's been a real privilege to work with staff. This has been a great project to work on, and I'm excited to take it from, you know, the 50% current set to, you know, let's get it out to bid and let's build it and really get moving.
Yeah. Commissioners, any other questions, comments?
I just have a couple comments, I guess. I'm very excited about the multimodal aspect of converting Prairie Avenue. I think that's a great decision. We, you know, are obviously a very single passenger vehicle oriented state, and so to see multimodalism put into that kind of cross-cutting roadway, I think is really exciting. I think overall, I think Wyoming's done a pretty good job of incorporating bike lanes, but I really like seeing it on that road as well. The, I guess, question or maybe consideration I want to put out there is around accessibility. You mentioned that, you know, having the appropriate grades for ADA for use of wheelchairs and things like that. I'm wondering if it's within your purview or if it's a staff consideration to bring in some folks from the disability community to really help ensure that there's kind of awareness and buy-in for the project as well, so that we're really expanding the sense of access and inclusion throughout the project.
So we have really good relationship locally with disability advocates of Grand Rapids. We have not engaged them yet on this project, but I think that's a really good idea, especially with where we're at, in particular in the design phase of where we are on the trails. We could still really easily incorporate some of those potential improvements and buy-in that they could give us.
Thank you. I do want to reiterate that Progressive has done an excellent job of keeping this trail ADA compliant. Tim is probably underselling the difficulty of doing that on the trail behind Hook and making sure that that was accessible. There have been a couple of changes along the way, as initially we had planned to go over the sledding hill at one point and determined that it just wasn't possible, which is why we're curving the way we are down into Pinery Park.
Yeah, it looks great. It looks great. I just wanted to throw that out there as an additional component for consideration.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, and another light bulb turned on. Part of the reason that we're also proposing that helical pier option is it's the least invasive as far as what's necessary for construction for tree removal. We have some really nice mature trees all along the slope of that hill, which number one are beautiful and should be preserved, but number two also provide a lot of stability to the slope. So we wanted to keep that in a nice serene environment and preserve everything that we could. So the helical pier solution costs a little bit more, but I think it provides really good value by what it does.
Thank you. Well done.
I think it was great. This is like the master plan process, listening to people, especially younger people.
Yep.
Like, this is just fantastic. I have three teens and one preteen. Like, they're gonna eat this up. This communicates something, I think, to people that they've been heard. It's really cool.
That's
Prairie Parkway.
Great point.
It is.
No, it's a great point. We need to sell that. How do we sell that?
Right, people, you've asked for it.
Yeah,
it's happening.
Yep.
Prairie Parkway, when I saw the street paint, east of Taft, west of Burlingame, that freaks me out, because that's a speed zone. People are like barreling around that parkway. Yep. And I'm just picturing a bike 4 feet from that. I'm sure that's something traffic's gonna pay attention to, but
Chris, that when your speed bumps would go in there.
Yeah, maybe we can look into incorporating some
roundabouts.
What's that?
Roundabouts.
Well, I mean, that helps, but maybe there are some other ways to slow down traffic without necessarily putting speed bumps or anything like that. You guys know all about that, the little bump outs and some other measures, because you're absolutely right. I know a person that got a ticket there going and then coming back, got a second ticket. So people do speed there a lot.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's great work.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you.
Thank you, Tim.
All right. Officially, I am going to open public comment and close public comment. I do have a couple announcements before we make adjournment tonight. So like the new commissioners, like when you came, I asked you just to give a couple minutes spiel about who you are and your background. So I've already asked Roger and Alex if they could just give us a little, you know, give the new commissioners, us here, a little idea on what they do and their background. So, Alex, if you would kick off again. And by the way, commissioners, Alex was a planning commissioner a few years back, and he sat in that same spot. Yes. And he's back into that same spot.
I'm back. Yes, I took a little detour. My wife and I, a few years ago, close to 4 years ago now, got an invitation to move to Nashville to work. And so that's why I left the Planning Commission back then. A previous employer here in Grand Rapids called me and convinced me to come back. So now we're back. But thank you for the opportunity to join you. I guess my background, I'm an architect. I worked at Progressive for many years, about 7.5, 8 years. I've been practicing in the architecture field in general for about 34 years. Probably the last half of my career, I have been involved on the owner side of the business. I was at the Grand Rapids Public Schools for about 12.5 years. Then I went to Kendall College as a director of facilities and operations. Then I went to Tennessee State University in Nashville as the executive director of planning and design. And now I'm back with the Grand Rapids Public Schools as executive director of facilities and operations. So I have a pretty good understanding as an owner what to look for. Maybe that's why I was asking some of these questions about maintaining the building, because that's an important aspect of what we do. And then, of course, I have the architecture and design background and construction documents and from the first half of my career. So
thank you. Very nice.
Thank you.
Roger.
Well, I am a registered civil engineer, and have been working in the engineering field in many different capacities as owner, as an employee. I started out with Williams and Works for a year in their surveying department, and then moved to the city of Grand Rapids for 10 years. And when I left there, I was acting assistant city engineer and did their long-term planning, water and sewer development, where to bring all the main lines. And then I was asked by Steelcase to help them out when they started their major building projects. So I developed about 3 square miles of property at 52nd to 60th to 68th, all the way out to 72nd Street between East Paris and Patterson. So I did a master planning there, and then they decided not to build anymore. And so let me go, or right-size me, however you want to say it. And then I worked for a small architectural engineering firm and came to this place representing customers, clients. So I've been on both sides of the bar, if you want to call it that. But so I've started my own little engineering firm. I had Lamer Engineering LLC for 7 years, 8 years. When COVID hit, I was spending more money on liability insurance than I was on getting employment. So I have dropped my state registration, and I have dropped my LLC. So now I'm here.
Well, welcome. Glad to have you both on board.
Thank you.
My last announcement before I adjourn is a great announcement. I'd like you all to know that Paul Smith has been promoted to the Assistant Director of Community and Economic Development.
Way to go.
Congratulations. Congratulations. So with that, commissioners, if no other questions, comments, or concerned, great meeting tonight. Adjourned.